Hey, good morning. Paul Carlson here, small workshop guy. I'm going to give you a workshop tour today. I'm using an iPhone 7 on a gimbal, so hopefully it won't be too ragged. I'll try to do it quickly, although it is going to take a little time to explain everything that I've got in my workshop. Or my workshop is 10 foot wide, 20 foot long, so about 200 square feet. I'll let you translate that to square meters if you're overseas or in Australia or down under somewhere. So anyway, along the right-hand side, the design and the layout is to have the table saw as the main device with an open space where I can put in some saw horses. I call them Sawstallions for various uses, or I can open it up and move other tools into there. And then further down, I have my samurai carpenter workbench. Then I have an aisle going all the way from front to back so that I can move and get down to places and also move tools in and out where they need to be. On the left-hand side, it's organized with everything on mobile bases. All right, let's do a little bit more detail. Coming back here to the garage door opening, on the right-hand side in the corner, there's always space for wood storage. And I kind of have, the only thing I put there are some sacrificial 2x4s that I use for breaking down sheet goods. And then I have a wall here where I hang up various jigs. You're looking at, in the front there, a mini cross-cut sled with match-fit dovetail grooves in it. And also behind that is a tall fence board straightener tapering match fit dovetail jig that I built. I like the Micra Express cross-cut sled with a really precise miter, but I only drag that out and set it up for when I'm doing detailed angular stuff. I use a IVAC switch here so that my dust collection system will come on whenever I turn on whatever tool is plugged into that. Normally the tool is plugged into that is my table saw. On the wall is an underpowered Shop Fox 1 horsepower dust collection system that's hooked up to the table saw the majority of the time, but I do have this supplemental hose that I can quickly put on to the dust collection system and then hook up to the port on my jointer. All right, sitting on top of my SawStop PCS 30, I wish I had more room width. I'd love to be able to put a router table embedded in that where that piece of wood is just sitting right now. That's not embedded in my saw, that's just sitting there. You know how horizontal spaces are. If they're available, you start using them. On the SawStop, I have placed my crosscut sled, and that's kind of designed with match fit dovetail grooves as well. Then I have a long bar on that that's got all sorts of measurements on it, and I can put that on that crosscut sled in order to give myself an extension arm off to the left and use my stop block on that. This is the Jonathan Katz Moses stop block. And let's see, so that's my table saw. Underneath the table saw to use the storage, I have 2 red barrels, big old red barrels from Ace. One takes the offcuts that are going to go to the dump yard, and then another one under there has offcuts that I might use later. You know how that is, you store them for a couple years and then you finally get rid of them. And then I have even some additional offcuts in a little carton or crate of some sort. I forgot what that is, an orange crate or something. All right. I have a mag switch feather board and just some push sticks that I've made. But primarily, I use the micro jig push sticks. What do they call those? Grippers of various types. And those are actually attached to my garage door, which normally is down, so they're right behind my table saw where I can reach them, along with a set of protective eyeglasses and hearing protection device in case I've forgotten to bring those from the other side of the garage. And now I also have a little rack here to hold my match fit dovetail clamps. All right, moving inside. Right now in my open space, which is a space between my table saw and my workbench, I have my, I guess I'd call them samurai carpenter saw horses. I call them Sawstallions. I have customized them so that the side of the top is flush with the legs. That way I can put a dovetail groove all the way down, and that gives me some superior clamping capabilities if I need it. I have match fit dovetail grooves on the top of the Sawstallions as well. And here you can see how that can be used for all sorts of clamping. I find that a lot of things are cumbersome to clamp elsewhere, and with these custom Sawstallions, because you can put them in the carport, you can put them in the driveway, you can get them close together, you can spread them out, you can use them to cut down sheet goods, you can always get clamps underneath stuff and between things. So I just, it's my primary thing when I want to do a little bit of work and I want to do some clamping. I find it much, much easier and much more flexible than trying to clamp things to my fixed workbench. So anyway, I just have a little drill press table that I'm finishing up with my router sitting on top of it just to demonstrate that clamping. If you don't have these yet, I'd highly recommend them. These are little Veritas bench saddles or platform saddles. You just stick them into bench dog holes in the top of a 2x4 or something, and then you can put a sacrificial 2x4 in there, and then you can put your sheet goods across that in order to support your cut. The dust collection system, I've added a cyclone to it. There's a top from Rockler that's got a cyclone kind of a device in the top of it on a 32-gallon barrel from Home Depot. And literally 99.9% of everything goes into that barrel, and very little goes into that dust bag, which is good because it's a hassle to change or to empty out. Up above or to the left of the dust collection system is my clamp rack. Everybody's got one of those. They all look similar. Well, they're different, but whatever works for you. So I got a lot of Bessie panel clamps as well as pipe clamps. Sustainers are kind of right here. I've got four or five tools that come in sustainers, and so they're just stacked up. I love the way those things fit together. And then I've got some other storage boxes for some sanding supplies, and on top of there is my little glue station that I grab quickly. To the left of that, I've got my jig for pocket holes and the little compressor to run some of the pneumatic tools. All right, sitting on top of my samurai carpenter workbench, well, first under it is my Festool HEPA shop vac, and so I connect that to a number of my Festool tools. I don't have that many. I have three or four. They're pretty expensive. You got a budget for those puppies and save up for them, but man, once you get one, they are beautiful. So sitting on top of the workbench right now is a station. You say, what in the world is that? Well, all of those dominoes that you see there, tape, that's just a one-sided tape, are so that this device called the Shaper Origin, which is a CNC router. So it's got a computer on it. It connects by Wi-Fi. You can do designs in Adobe Illustrator and then send those to this device and then carve those designs in a workpiece. Or you could just, if you want to do a dado that's not going to be a through dado, this thing by itself just supports circle cutting and rectangular cutting. So you just decide what size dado you want. And it's extremely precise, and I'm having a lot of fun with it, including engraving some logo and some of the things that I do. Got the Domino 500, the smaller one, and I like to use my, not necessarily my go-to sander, but my one for special applications and polishing is the Rotex 90. I like that because you can put different heads on it for different applications, whether it be polishing or whether it be running it in the Rotex mode to really do some quick and heavy carving. I have a little device that I just throw up onto my workbench in order to protect it and in order to give me some clamping, so it's got some match fit dovetail grooves in it. So here I'm just demonstrating how you could use that to laminate something together and hold it down with some match fit grooves. And that just lives over here behind my apron when I'm not using it. I use a wax cotton apron. I actually have the Jonathan Katz Moses apron on order because his has got some leather pouches that he's put into it that are convenient for holding some tools that I want to hold. All right, so anyway, that's my workbench. It has two Veritas twin screw vices on it, one on the end as well as one on the side. Has some storage underneath. There I have my shooting boards and some just other miscellaneous router supplies. I love, and I have at my age, I have to have a rolling little work stool that's adjustable. All right, so that's kind of the left. Well, let's talk about the tool wall a little bit more. So over and near my, let me back up so you can see. Hang on, don't get dizzy. I'll try not to move too much. So on the wall up above my workbench, I have put in just a big piece of, I think, 24, 30 inch by 6 foot plywood, and then use wooden pegs. I'll show you the other side of the garage. I have the French cleat system. So over on one side, I've arranged all of my sort of measuring tools that I want in hand, my two-sided tape, my Incra, my fire extinguisher, my bench planes. Several of those are Lee Nielsen. One of them, the big number 7, is a Wood River. I've got the Lee Nielsen router plane and the Lee Nielsen little jack rabbit plane. You know what I mean. I can't come up with the name when I'm filming. All right. I like the Festool measuring tape. Have a set of mortising chisels from Narex. The little angular chisels from Narex, as well as the regular bench chisels. But my two favorite chisels are the Veritas half inch and quarter inch, and I use those majority of time. I have these three back saws from Veritas. Two of them are dovetail saws, one for under a half inch, one for half inch and three quarter, and then I've got the cross cut. My University of Kansas banner, because that's where I went, spent most of my childhood, is in Lawrence, Kansas, all the way from kindergarten through graduate school. And then here's just a place where I have about 40 different small clamps, as well as some of my hold downs and things for my bench, my workbench. All right, so that's that wall. Next to the workbench, let me go back as long as I'm in one section here. I have these built-in cabinets, and then on top of that, I have a nice iMac computer. There's the Small Workshop Guy website where you can find plans to my pop-up workbenches and plans to my Sawstallions. And then I just keep a number of tools there. And I've got a light that's got some charging devices on it, so I can keep my Bluetooth headsets charged up, as well as my gimbal that I'm using to film this. Space is critical in a small workshop, and so sitting next to my workbench. It'd be nice to be able to get all the way around the workbench, but you can't do that in a one-car garage. So I like to keep my sharpening station out where I can use it. If I have to do some grinding, then I have the slow-speed grinder down there, and then I have my Triton oscillating sander. And next to that is my DeWalt thickness planer. That's new. I replaced the Wen. Wasn't anything really wrong with the Wen. I just have some projects coming up, and I used them to rationalize upgrading my thickness planer. And I haven't yet put the helical heads on that, but all of my buddies tell me that I will want to do that. All right, so again, that is the right side of the garage. And then I use the up high space on the walls as well. Left hand side of the garage. So put up a French cleat system here in the back. We'll talk about that more in a second. Down on the floor, I've got the sander and then some accessories and stuff for the table saw right here where I need them. Put in the dado and so forth. In front of that, I have my thickness planer. This is a power, that's not a thickness planer, that's a jointer, Paul. Powermatic, 8-inch, 73-inch long, I think 2 horsepower, with the helical heads on that puppy. I'm gonna make some big Japanese style beds for 2 bedrooms of the Ishitani type that I see him do. I actually, in ordering my jointer from Amazon, which I would never do again because it came broken and then I had to replace it. Well, anyway, there was some mix up. I ended up with an extra base and an extra motor. So I may try to do a John Hayes type of thing and build myself a big old rotating belt sander of some length. All right, so I'm looking forward to that. I did a video even last week, said small workshop, how do you free up space? Get rid of your miter saw. Well, I lost a couple of sleepless nights and I spent a couple of days in the workshop using my jigsaw. And you know what? I just didn't like it. So during the night, I'm thinking, and I realized how I might be able to put a miter saw back in here and still have the space that I needed. So I moved my thickness planer over next to my workbench, and I added back a miter saw. But I didn't want to get a sliding miter saw because of space that requires in the back, unless you get the really expensive, who is it, Bosch? Excuse me. And so this is a DeWalt 12-inch fixed miter saw. And it only miters in one direction. Okay, and I have that sitting on a Bora Portamate. That Bora Portamate is on wheels. You can take it out in the driveway. You can also flip that miter saw underneath if you want a workbench on top. But I store my shop vac down here. It's a 6.5 horsepower Craftsman shop vac. I've added an extra long hose to it, so 10-foot hose instead of the normal 6 or 7 feet that come with it. And that helps me reach over to my drill press and my bandsaw. And then I incorporated into that the Cyclone using the dust stopper from Home Depot. And that works great. I'm really, really impressed for such an inexpensive arrangement. French cleat system. If you're not familiar with that, there's a zillion videos about it. And so you can see what I've got up there. Just different little cleats with screwdrivers and pliers and scissors and hammers. And this is a cool little sanding device for getting inside of small holes and stuff. It's kind of a belt sander, but portable, wired. And then I have another of those iVac systems so that when I plug in my miter saw there, my vacuum comes on automatically when the miter saw comes on. And that's good because I'm always forgetting about the vacuum or having to let it run and living with the noise. Back behind here, I have two little tops. One's a small one, one's a little larger one. Those are all designed with dog holes, as you can see, and match fit dovetail grooves. And when I throw those sawstallions out in the driveway, I can throw whichever top I want to on top of it. And I have a really quick pop-up workbench. All of my screws and stuff all labeled and organized. I got so tired of dealing with boxes and stuff. And then my corded Milwaukee circular saw, my corded DeWalt drill, my battery operated jigsaw, my drill drivers of various types, and my circular saw, battery operated. I focused or decided to centralize, not centralize, but to use the DeWalt systems 18 or 20 volt XR and try to get all the tools to work on that one same battery system. Little engraving that I did using my Shaper Origin for my workshop. Here's little simple devices that a lot of these tools are hanging on. They're just little hooks from Ace Hardware, and then you put them, you know, with the dovetail with the French cleat system on the back, and then you can move them anywhere you want to. And I've only had this French cleat system for maybe 2 months, and I can't tell you how many times I've rearranged everything in order to make it more practical and easier to reach things. On my miter saw, one of the things that bothered me was, well, how am I going to support work pieces to the right and to the left? Supporting work pieces to the right of the miter saw is not a problem because I've got an open doorway here. So this wing comes up, and then there's a platform that gets level with the miter saw. So I can support things on the right. I just have to kind of move my dust collection out of the way or my dust stopper. And I can pull this out. But what I found out and what I realized was I can put my jointer right here. And yes, it's the wrong height, so it can't support an out piece. But I thought, you know what? There's only a small difference there. Why don't you just build a little jig, Paul, which is nothing more than some oak with little wings on it, and make that exactly the right height so that then, let me grab a board and demonstrate. While I get this board, let me show you something else. I use a little supplemental storage out here in the carport where I keep some offcuts for my sheet goods. And maybe if I'm in the middle of a project, I store some of that project workings out there. These are my 2x4 sawstallions that I'm prototyping, and the plans will be available for free. And those only cost you about, I don't know, $40 or $50 to build. And then you too can have some sawstallions. You'll have to put some match fit dovetail grooves in them maybe. So anyway, I store my little router table out here. If I'm going to use it, fine. I move it into the shop. It's on a mobile stand, but no, I just one more item I don't have room for when I'm working in my shop. So I just kind of roll it out here at the beginning of the day, and then I roll it back in at night, or I roll it in if I'm going to use it. So speaking of supporting a workpiece on this miter saw, here's the way I work that out. So I can support the left hand side without moving my jointer, just by throwing that little bridge on there. And so now I've got, literally, if you look down that board, I can literally go till I hit that fence about 50 feet away. So unlimited space that way and unlimited space pretty much to the right. So now my miter saw can be used in both directions. All right, well, the only other thing I have to show you is my inexpensive bandsaw. That'll be the next thing that I upgrade. You can only upgrade so many things at a time, budget-wise. So I use the little storage systems underneath that to store things. I also have this right here and set at the proper height for my miter saw to the right-hand side, so I don't have to move my dust stopper and raise that wing. I can just set that roller bar up for the right-hand support. So the little wing, Wen, 10-inch, two-speed bandsaw. We'll probably replace it with a Rikon, 14-inch. Forget the model number. And then I've got a variable speed Wen drill press, and that works just fine. And I'm just finishing a new drill press table. And then again, down here, I have my Powermatic benchtop mortiser, which is not sitting on a benchtop because I don't use it that often and just can't eat up any valuable space. All right, so, and here's a little thing I found on the internet and ordered and put on my wall of all the different woods, well, not all the different wood species, but of wood species, so I kind of know what's what. Let me put the garage door down to demonstrate the storage on there. So this is the condition that I'm in most of the time when I'm working, which is with the garage door closed. And so I've got a little place on the garage door where I store my extra, all right, stop swinging, store my extra table saw blades and my grippers and some of my match fit clamps that aren't already on all the jigs. And then for wood storage, I happen to be lucky enough that my garage ceiling, I guess, is taller than most. So I've got a good 4 foot up above my garage door opener or rails. And so I just put in a mezzanine platform up there. And I've got a project in the works up there, and I got some extra pipe clamps stored up there, and gotta try not to use that for too many things, keep it for wood storage. And then over on the other side, I just have wood, and yes, I gotta get a step stool to get up there and grab things, but that's not that hard. Everybody's got their own styles, everybody's got their own things that they do and the kinds of things that they need, so your selection of tools may be different than mine. But you can definitely, if you work hard at it, get a lot of stuff in a one-car garage and have a lot of fun for the rest of your life doing a little woodworking. Please give me a like, give me a comment, give me a subscription. And if you want to be in very rare company, go to Patreon. There's a link down below and sign up to chip in $1 or $2 a month to help the old coot cover some of his software costs. Small workshop guy, hoping you'll be safe in your workshop. Have a great week.